Good day, everyone. I'm Mary Texera. I just used to teach in the Department of Sociology here at Cal State San Bernardino and have been involved with the conversations on race and policing since its inception 3 years ago with the killing of George Floyd. We have had some remarkable guests, and this week is no exception. Professor Sahar Aziz from Rutgers University will enlighten us on what is going on with law enforcement and Muslims in general these days for the anti-woke crowd, I guess, who are at the forefront of all of this. But anyway, I will not delay. I want to hand this over to my colleague, Matt Patino, who will be doing a land acknowledgement. Matt?
Hi, everybody. My name is Matt Patino. I am an adjunct instructor of history at Crafton Hills College. I am also a former police officer with the city of Rialto here in California. We recognize that California State University San Bernardino sits on the territory and ancestral land of the San Manuel Band of Mission Indians, the Juhaviatam. We recognize that every member of the California State University San Bernardino community has benefited and continues to benefit from the use and occupation of this land since the institution's founding in 1965. Consistent with our values of community and diversity, we have a responsibility to acknowledge and make visible the university's relationship to Native peoples. By offering this land acknowledgement, we affirm indigenous sovereignty and will work to hold the California State University San Bernardino more accountable to the needs of American Indian and indigenous peoples. And now I'll turn it over to Robbie.
Thank you, Matt. My name is Robbie Madrigal from the Fowle Library. I, like Mary, I'm also one of the founding members of this program. I'll turn it over to my colleague, Mike German.
Thanks, Robbie. Hi, everyone. I'm Mike German. I'm a fellow with the Brennan Center for Justice at NYU Law School and a former FBI special agent. It's my pleasure today to introduce you to Sahar Aziz, Distinguished Professor of Law and Chancellor Social Justice Scholar at Rutgers Law School in Newark, New Jersey. Professor Aziz's scholarship examines the intersection of national security, race, religion, and civil rights, with a focus on the adverse impact of national security laws and policies on racial, religious, and ethnic minorities. She's the founding director of the Center for Security, Race, and Rights, and the author of the book, The Racial Muslim: When Racism Quashes Religious Freedom. I encourage you to explore the Center for Security, Race, and Rights website and follow the Race and Rights podcast, and I'll put links into the chat so you can follow those. Sahar, we've been friends a long time. It's a pleasure to see you again. Tell us about your research and how we tend to think of racial profiling by law enforcement in terms of race, but your work has focused on the racializing of Muslim Americans in the national security context. So welcome, and we're eager to hear from you.
Thank you, Mike. It's so nice to see you virtually, and it's nice to see Professor Patino and Professor Texiera and everyone in the audience. Thank you for attending. It's my pleasure to be here. I always wish that my research would become expired and that it would no longer be too relevant, but unfortunately, it continues to be relevant for all the wrong reasons, which is the continued rise of Islamophobia, anti-Muslim racism, and bias against Arabs and Palestinians and South Asians, who are often mistaken as homogeneously Muslim. So as Mike mentioned, I have committed most of my career to combating anti-Muslim bias or racism or Islamophobia, largely because of the lived reality that me, my family, my community, or the diverse Muslim communities have experienced over the last 23 years. And so it has ebbed and flowed, but it has not gone away. And that was effectively the reason that I decided to write The Racial Muslim When Racism Quashes Religious Freedom, because around 2017, 2018, which is when I started writing the book, I realized that that Islamophobia is part of the permanent racial landscape in America. Just like anti-Semitism, just like anti-Black racism, just like anti-Latino and Latina bias and xenophobia and anti-Asian racism. There are just there are particular groups who historically, and obviously racism against Native Americans, there has historically always been certain forms of bias that have become entrenched. And they may go on hiatus. They may flare up, but they don't seem to go away. And I think that's why it's so important for all of us to always learn about those various histories and to understand the interconnections between them. And so Islamophobia has become added to that list. And so I think what's important is for anybody who does care about racial justice and about diversity, equity, inclusion, or pluralism, religious freedom. I mean, it's a spectrum, whether you want to be centrist or if you want to be more progressive and further to the left, you have to understand how Islamophobia works if you want to dismantle the various systems and structures that cause bias against one or more particular minority communities. Yeah, because you really cannot understand them in isolation. So I just wanted to start with that. And the way in which I have worked on these issues, one has been through my research, which I'll talk a little bit about my latest article called Race Entrapment and the Manufacturing of Homegrown Terrorism in a minute, but also through the Center for Security, Race, and Rights at Rutgers Law School, which you can visit our website at csrr.rutgers.edu. And we also have a new podcast we just launched called the Race and Rights Podcast. And that center is the only civil rights center at an American law school in the entire country that focuses on the human and civil rights of Muslims, Arabs, and South Asians in the United States and abroad. And so that we have three themes. One is criminalizing Muslim identity, not that we support it, but we want to decriminalize it by identifying that that is effectively what has happened, is that Muslim identity has become criminalized as terrorism supporters, violent, and most recently, the most common stereotype is that Muslims are anti-Semitic, and which again is very much tied to the geopolitical conflicts in the Middle East, and particularly right now with Israel's my position, and I've made it public, but my position is that Israel has engaged in acts of genocide in Gaza insofar as multiple violations of international law, and to the extent that it is likely to be found to be genocidal. But again, the International Court of Justice is now looking into the merits of those allegations brought by South Africa. We also look at the color of religion. So the various ways in which religious freedom is denied to certain faiths from the Native Americans their faith and their religions were not even considered legitimate or bona fide by the Protestant dominant religion, dominant at least socially and culturally in the United States, to Muslim or Hindu or other religions that don't fit into what is now this Judeo-Christian identity in the U.S. And so although anti-Semitism is part of American religious bigotry and racial and racism, so is anti-Catholic racism and anti-Mormon racism. And I say racism because people are effectively racialized based on their religious identity. And for example, with Catholics 100 years ago, you would often find that they were accused of being loyal to the Pope and not to the United States. Similarly with Jews, the anti-Semitic tropes were that they were part of some broader global conspiracy, that they had multiple loyalties, and these were racialized stereotypes. And similarly with Muslims, the stereotype is that they are supporters of terrorist groups. So whether it's ISIS, Al-Qaeda, Hamas, Hezbollah, any group that has used violence for a politically motivated purpose, oftentimes the purpose could be what they declare is liberation of a land or self-determination of a people, or it could be overturning certain regimes and creating the so-called caliphate, as ISIS and Al-Qaeda claimed. But what happens, the way that Muslims are racialized, is that by virtue of being Muslim, especially if they're religious, then suddenly they're presumed to be loyal to these violent or these political organizations that use violence in pursuit of their political objectives. So this homogenization, this essentialization of 1.8 billion people across the globe is a form of racism. And oftentimes Americans are more familiar with the form of racism that was used against African Americans, where it was based very much on what they looked like, their phenotype. And so by being Black, or by having certain hair texture or facial features that were of African ancestry, then that would impute upon them all of these different biological-like inferiority traits. And so essentially what my research does, and what we do also at the Center for Security, Race, and Rights, is show that religious identity also does work in racializing various religious minority groups. And then finally, we do transnational rights and security, which is connecting what happens abroad with the racialization of Muslim, Arab, and South Asian communities in the US. For example, right now, as we speak, the way in which Palestinians are being racialized as terrorists, as anti-Semitic, and the way in which the conflict and the war, and again, the genocide in Gaza, or what happened in Israel on October 7th, 2023, the way that it is discussed and the way that Palestinians are portrayed is very much through a racial lens. And that then carries into the United States, where if someone is Palestinian American or Arab American or Muslim American, and they are engaging in constitutionally protected speech and protest, teach-ins, sit-ins, very American traditions, they are, instead of being recognized for what it is, which is political dissent that is protected by the Constitution, it is effectively criminalized and vilified as anti-Semitic and hateful. And that is something that comes with being part of a subordinated group and a racialized group. And again, that doesn't mean that one can't disagree on the merits with certain protests and certain messaging, but there's a big difference between saying, I disagree with you because of these facts or because of this analysis or these differences of analysis, rather than you are a criminal, right? What you are doing is criminal, it's hateful, and it's a threat to the safety of other people. And in this case, allegations that it is a threat to all Jews, notwithstanding that there are many Jewish Americans that are participating in the protests against what Israel is doing in Gaza. So that is a very long-winded way of describing some of the research I do, but also the way that the Center for Security, Race, and Rights institutionalizes those various topics. And again, I'll just encourage people, if you want to learn more, go to our YouTube channel, Center for Security, Race, and Rights, and we have over 90 lectures by academics and experts on these issues. So I'll just use the final few minutes to go, if you don't mind, I'll use a PowerPoint. I just want to bring a little bit of visualization to my latest project. So give me a second here while I share my screen. Okay, so for those who want to read the entire law review article, came out in the Georgetown Law Journal, it's called Race Entrapment and Manufacturing Homegrown Terrorism, and it is on my SSRN page, so Social Science Research Network, SSRN.com, and you can look me up. And effectively, these were the overarching research questions that I asked when conducting this research. And the first is, well, to what extent is U.S. counterterrorism enforcement racialized to disproportionately harm Muslims' civil rights and civil liberties? And this is, again, a research question that applies to the way in which national security has been enforced in the United States since 2021. And I also was looking at selective enforcement and resource allocation and disparate criminal charges and disparate sentencing. And ultimately, what this paper really argues is that the FBI has been engaging in abusive investigative techniques and abusing sting operations to manufacture terrorism-related charges. And I put in quotes, terrorism-related, because oftentimes the actual criminal charge is something like making a false statement to an FBI agent or a federal agent, or unlawful possession of a gun, or something that is not directly related to terrorism, but they will claim it's terrorism related. And oftentimes it's because of the identity of the defendant being Muslim. So this is the third in a trilogy of articles, or excuse me, the second. The first one is state-sponsored radicalization. That's also available on my SSRN page. And then the next one that's forthcoming is going to be looking at the difference between how Muslim defendants are treated and how what we'll call in quotes, kind of right-wing extremists or the January 6th, 2021 insurgents were treated criminally, to be able to see if there's in fact disparity. So the thesis is that racialized counterterrorism enforcement manufactures, or at the very least inflates, homegrown terrorism cases by targeting vulnerable Muslim men in predatory sting operations, while entrapment law fails to protect individuals from government overreach. And for those of us who are lawyers, that's a very important failure, because entrapment law is supposed to, by design, stop these types of abuses, whomever the targets, the identity of the targets may be. And what's very clear from my research, and many criminal defense lawyers know this, is that entrapment law is completely useless. It fails to protect 99% of defendants who allege that they're being entrapped from being entrapped in fact. So the political economy of counterterrorism is really important to understand. It, to some extent, this has started to wane since the Biden administration, since Biden came into office, but it was certainly front and center for most of our domestic law enforcement agencies, which is first is counterterrorism is preventative by design. That's still the case, except when you're dealing with politically motivated violence by white Christian groups. So if you notice, January 6, 2021 had been, those groups had been organizing for a long time. They'd existed, they were growing. They really grew significantly in membership under Obama. And yet there was very little preventative measures. And in contrast to the way Muslim communities have been treated, these communities, it's been reactive. It's post January 6th, as opposed to pre. Also, the FBI budget tripled from $3 billion to $10 billion in 20 years. And 40% of that increase was on counterterrorism. Now, not all of it was domestic, but the domestic and the international, you can't really disconnect it. And those agents and the DOJ lawyers who worked on counterterrorism and on these terrorism-related cases that, again, almost all were Muslim defendants, would find themselves on a fast track to promotion and receiving awards. So it paid off professionally to investigate and prosecute Muslims. And so for 20 years, the media portrayed Islam and Muslims exclusively through the terrorism lens, and these cases just legitimated and validated that racial frame. And also elected officials did what we call officiating Islamophobia. And we're seeing that today, specifically in the Palestine-Israel issue, where people who are defending Palestinian human rights are accused of supporting Hamas, which is a designated terrorist group, as opposed to, for example, criticized for misinterpreting international law, or criticized for disagreeing with Israeli policy, military policy, or disagreeing with U.S. foreign policy. No, they are being accused of being terrorists and terrorist supporters. That is a direct extension and continuation of what we saw in the post 9/11 era in this kind of political economy of counterterrorism. And I say political economy because elected officials are winning votes. They're raising money based on these racial tropes, The House Committee on Education and Workforce is, these Republican members are raising money, millions of dollars, by essentially accusing universities of condoning anti-Semitism based on the evidence that, what is the evidence? Allegedly that you have all these students who are effectively dissenting against US foreign policy and in providing military aid to Israel and in not cutting off foreign aid, or at least not criticizing Israel for its violations of international law. And then finally, juries are primed to presume guilt of Muslim defendants. And so when you look at the cases we looked at, there were 645, very few of them, very few Muslims, just a handful, less than 10 were acquitted. And almost everybody else pled guilty or was convicted. So what is the anatomy of a sting operation? So first, and so this is effectively the way it works. There's an online covert unit with the FBI or other law enforcement agencies, and they search for so-called extremist content on social media and chat rooms. Then they make direct contact electronically with the individual. They set up a physical meeting after that. They introduce the male Muslim male target, and 99%, 99.9% are Muslim males, to a fake ISIS or Al-Qaeda member who is usually an undercover FBI agent or maybe an informant. And then they selectively record the conversations to have them, and they persuade them to declare loyalty, or what they call bayan, to ISIS and Al-Qaeda. And once they do that, they then induce the target to go from extremist speech, which is protected by the Constitution, to predicate acts in furtherance of a fake terrorist plot. And that it's fake because it's the FBI that agent that usually comes up with the plot. It's the FBI agent that usually provides the means and opportunity. And it's the FBI agent that is often multiple agents that are effectively egging on the target to commit one act in furtherance of it so that they can arrest them. And the average time spent on a sting operation is 10 months. So that gives you an idea of how much persuasion is required and how much cajoling is required and how much effort is required for the FBI to convince their target to go from speech to a predicate act. And I think that is evidence of manufactured plot and bad faith. So the government will argue that countering terrorism is preventative. And therefore, if we don't grab these so-called Muslim homegrown terrorists off the streets, then a real terrorist organization will recruit them. And, you know, Anwar al-Awlaki was a target of an extrajudicial assassination by the United States through a drone. But he used to be someone who was very active in promoting al-Qaeda through online spaces. There was something called Inspire magazine, there were YouTube, there were chat rooms. And so the FBI's argument was, we want to catch the consumers of this propaganda before the terrorists recruit them. And they will also say there's nothing unusual here. Informants and undercover agents are a staple part of law enforcement. We've always used them, whether it's against organized crime or against drug cartels. And so there really is nothing unusual that justifies this critique. And also the sting operations are a common form of crime prevention. But if you look at who are these individuals, and I highlighted 12 different cases out of the 600, well, out of the 645 cases that are in our database, and I'll show you the website on CSIR, the webpage that shows the database if you want to go through it, about 250 of them are sting operations. So that's a significant percentage. And of those sting operations, a significant amount are what we call vulnerable Muslim men. So let's look at a couple of these cases to see just how vulnerable they are. So Harlem Suarez was someone who was targeted. He had an IQ of 70 because at birth he was deprived of oxygen, which caused him cognitive deficiencies. He had immigrated from Cuba to the US at the age of 12, and he had attempted suicide at the age of 15. He then converted to Islam, And he did not own a car. He worked as a cook at a restaurant, so at a very low wage job. And he lived with his parents. At age 24, he began posting ISIS propaganda on Facebook. And effectively, this undercover unit then identified that and targeted him for this sting operation. One informant and two undercover agents essentially ensnared him into a fake bomb plot. Suarez attempted to avoid the government operatives on numerous occasions, but they were very, very persistent. And ultimately, and so they convinced him to take a what we call a predicate act in furtherance of it, and then they arrested him. Once he was arrested, he was psychologically evaluated, and it found that he suffered from significant emotional, cognitive, or behavioral dysfunction. And as I said, his IQ was 70 due to complications at birth. And yet, he was sentenced to life without parole. And the United States government, in the press release, made it out as if they had just stopped, a very serious, dangerous terrorist from killing Americans. So this is just one example. I have multiple others that I include in my paper, but nobody, these types of facts obviously are not highlighted by the government. So the data makes gives you a false impression that the government is actually fighting real terrorists rather than manufacturing terrorism in order to justify all of the funds that come to the FBI and also to continue what we call kind of this counterterrorism industrial complex. So the normative conclusions from the empirical data is, or empirical analysis, is that government informants and undercover agents develop, lead, and implement fake terrorist plots ensnaring Muslim targets who are often inept, indigent, young, or recently released from prison, which all of this collectively or individually makes them very vulnerable to being targets. Also, it is First Amendment protected activity on social media that attracts the government informants and undercover agents tasked with executing sting operations. So it's really problematic that that is effectively what gets you, makes you a target, as opposed to you were engaging in some conduct that put you on the government's radar screen. Similarly, when it's time to show entrapment, and entrapment, just in a nutshell, is if you can show that the government ensnared you, right? They used gov they ensnared you into or induced you into committing a crime, and that you were not predisposed to commit that crime before the government ensnared you, then that is entrapment. But the government will respond and say, no, this target was already predisposed to commit the crime, and we just provided the target means an opportunity, which does not constitute entrapment, legally speaking. So, for example, in a drug context, if somebody is predisposed to sell drugs and the informant or the government agent just says, here are the drugs that you can sell, and so they take the drugs from the agent, they sell them, they get arrested, that would not be entrapment. But you would have the government would have to show evidence that this target was looking to sell drugs, and all they did is provide the person with the drugs to sell. So the problem with this context is they go and point to the First Amendment protected activity as the predisposition, which is effectively offensive, and certainly extreme in terms of not mainstream speech that may praise ISIS or Al-Qaeda. But that's very different than actually intending to commit terrorism. And so that this is where you get kind of the bootstrapping. And then finally, the entrapment jurisprudence, which I go into in the paper and I won't go into here, it fails to take into account the positionality of the defendant, meaning that many of these defendants, because they're so vulnerable, they don't know how to use a gun. They don't even have passports, some of them, yet they're accused of attempting to travel abroad to support terrorism. They don't have any money, or very, very little money. They don't have cars. So they're not in a position, nor do they have the skills to actually conduct the terrorist acts that they're being accused of. But still, entrapment law does not protect them. Okay, so I am going to stop sharing my screen and show you just, excuse me, I'm going to show you. I will share my screen. I'm going to show you the website quickly. Let's see, did this work? Let me try this again. Sorry. Let's One more thing. I just want to show you the data that we created, the web page that allows people who want to look at this, fiddle with it a little bit more. Okay, so you should see it, yeah. So if you go to csrr.rutgers.edu under issues and under criminalizing Muslim identity, it's under manufacturing terrorism. And if you take a look at this, let's look at that. You can see here, we looked at, we separated them by false statements, charges by race. And we also separated them by cases with immigrant charges by race. And the reason we did that is because false statements, it's just lying to the federal, to the government. That is not terrorism related necessarily. And immigration charges is you're effectively out of status in, you know, in violation of immigration laws in one way or the other. And so if you look at this, you can see that 14 of the cases, or 38% of the total false statement cases, were Middle Eastern. So we broke it down by race. And some of the interesting data we found is that, you know, if you look at Latino and 2.78%, so that's one case, but Central Asian, two cases, Black, four cases, White, six, although White, it's difficult to know if they're Middle Eastern or if they're of European origin because of the census, South Asian, four, Somali, and then we had other cases. So this just gives you a breakdown of the different cases if you want to take a look at that. And then we also looked at gun charges and material support and broke it down by race. And then finally, entrapment, sting operations and entrapment by race. So as you can see, Middle Easterners were among the highest, but you also had 69 cases where the defendant was Somali. They was part of a sting operation. 211 were Middle Eastern, but interestingly, you have 114 that were Black, the defendants, 25 cases were Central Asian, 24 cases were Latino. So it's not just Middle Easterners is just something to take away. Okay, so I will stop there so that we can go into the Q&A. But if you, what I would encourage everybody that's watching, if you want to know more, is I would go to the website to go through the cases and also to read the article, and there's a lot more detail there. Thank you.
Great, thank you very much. And for the audience members, if you have a question you'd like to ask Professor Aziz now, you can type that into the Q&A function and we'll make sure to monitor that and ask your question for you. But before that becomes populated, let's talk a little bit about the terminology, because I think the terminology the government uses can sometimes be misleading. For example, you use the term homegrown terrorism, which is something that the FBI uses to describe these kind of cases. But one might assume that white supremacist violence like Ku Klux Klan terrorism would be considered homegrown, right? That's a group that started here in the United States. But that's not what the FBI means by homegrown terrorism.
Right. And if I'm not mistaken, Mike, I believe they came up with this new term, well, they call it domestic violent.
Violent extremism.
Is it domestic violent extremism?
Right. And that would encompass white supremacist violence or anarchist violence or some other kinds of types of violence that are homegrown. But when they say the term homegrown terrorist, they're only talking about one particular community.
Right, Muslims, yeah. And actually, I wrote an article recently. It was a book chapter called Different Names, Same Aim. And it looked, it's on also on my SSRN page, and it looks at how they change all these names around, but it actually means they're doing exactly the same thing, which is effectively to focus primarily on Muslims for preventative counterterrorism. Whereas with when it's white defendants that are on the political right, they tend to be more reactive. In other words, they first commit the crime and then they prosecute them. And I know that was very different in the 90s, because this is something where you have a lot more experience in this. And I don't know if they've changed and reverted back to the 90s when they were more preventative, which is probably because of the Timothy McVeigh Oklahoma bombing that kind of forced them to have to pay attention, presumably, to violent, politically motivated violence on the right. It's not clear to me that they're doing that after January 6th. And again, I'm not somebody, and I think Mike, you and I agree on this. I'm not proposing that the government should be surveilling churches or surveilling political dissidents on the right. I'm simply just pointing out that they do so against Muslims and, I would argue, the political left, and don't seem to think that that's un-American in any way, that that's just patriotic, legitimate counterterrorism or crime prevention. But they don't do that on the political right, and especially when the targets are white, because that frame is, oh, no, we can't infringe on their First Amendment activity. And so no matter how extreme their beliefs are or their rhetoric, that's still protected American activity and protected constitutional activity. And only if they cross the line and commit a crime will we then kind of use our law enforcement resources to punish them. And I'm interested to hear your perspective, Mike, but I don't think that's changed.
It hasn't very much. And the reason I brought up the terminology is because the government has different tools for addressing international terrorism, terrorists committed by groups abroad. And there are national security implications of that kind of violence, where domestic terrorists that are here in the United States have constitutional protections, which is why you have a different set of tactics for that. And one of the tactics that they use in international terrorists is something called material support for terrorism, which allows non-terrorist support. In other words, any support you provide to a foreign terrorist organization is criminalized. And explain how this law is used in these sting operations.
Right. So 182339 A or B or C, and that's the material support to terrorism. Now, in order for that to work, it's material support, as you said, to a foreign terrorist organization. And in the United States, we do not have a domestic group designated. Well, it can't be a foreign terrorist organization because it's not foreign, but also we don't have domestic terrorist lists, which I think I support that. I don't think we should have domestic terrorist lists. I think that people are either criminals or they're not, because once you get into domestic terrorism lists, you're just going down the slippery slope of criminalizing dissent and criminalizing views that are outside the mainstream. But when we're in the international sphere, that is not the case. One, the U.S. Constitution generally doesn't apply abroad. But still, then what's happening domestically, if somebody, for example, is accused of sending money to a country where a designated terrorist group operates, they may claim, look, I'm sending this money to a family member who is having economic problems. That family member could be in Gaza where Hamas operates, or in Somalia where Shabab operates, or in southern Lebanon where Hezbollah operates, or Iraq where Al-Qaeda operates. And the government will use that money that was sent and claim, no, you gave it to a terrorist organization. And if you're lucky, you can find the evidence after you're indicted. And if you decide to go to trial rather than take a plea, because the chances you're going to get a jury that isn't going to walk in presuming that you are amenable to being a terrorist if you are Muslim, it's a very big risk to take. But if you actually go to trial, then you would have to show that, in fact, that money did not go to that terrorist organization. And as we know, there's a case called the Humanitarian Law Project, which makes it even more difficult to prove that, because the government successfully argue that the fungibility of money theory, which is, for example, in that case, an American former administrative judge wanted to provide training and expertise to the a Kurdish dissident group that had been designated as a terrorist group in the United States, and wanted to train them on how to resolve the conflict peacefully with Turkey or with Iraq. And the government said, well, whatever material support you provide, even if it's, whether it's money or whether it's skills or whether it's expertise, you are saving that particular terrorist group money and time and resources that they would then redirect into the violent actions that they take. And so effectively, it just made any designated terrorist group completely radioactive, and any non-terrorist organization like a hospital or a school, if even one member of the board is associated in any way with a terrorist group such as Hamas in Gaza, then even giving money to that hospital would be material support to terrorism under that, what I think, very tenuous, flawed theory. So all that is to say that if you are somebody in the US, even as a US citizen, and you have any connections abroad in an area where there is a designated group, it's much easier to charge you or accuse you of providing material support to a foreign terrorist organization. And this is one of those charges that once you're charged, it's very difficult to get out from under it, primarily because, the trial process, it's very risky. And a lot of lawyers will tell their clients, you're better off pleading guilty and getting lesser time than taking the risk of going to a jury that has been completely primed for 20 years to believe that Muslims and Arabs and Middle Easterners are terrorist sympathizers.
And this is also, I think, what really raises the issue that you mentioned about the government agent, the undercover agent and the informant being the claiming to be the terrorist organization. In other words, it's manufacturing a case, because if I, as a government agent, come to you who might have said some scary things online, but if I go to you and say, hi, my name's Mike, I'm part of a white supremacist terrorist group, you're engaging with me is not a crime. But if I say I'm Al Qaeda or I'm ISIS and you engage with me and you provide support to me, all of a sudden that's a crime, even though there is no actual terrorist involved, no actual terrorist group involved.
Right. No, that's an excellent point. Yes. I mean, I was talking about when someone's actually engaged abroad, even if they're not directly dealing with a foreign terrorist organization. But yes, it makes it much easier for sting operations to favor the government.
Yeah. And part of what the government uses in these cases is that implicates their First Amendment rights, your speech rights, is this concept of terrorist radicalization. And, you know, people who've studied the FBI historical instances of racial abuse will think of the COINTELPRO program, where Dr. Reverend Martin Luther King was treated as a radical. That's what he was called, a radical preacher. And that justified FBI surveillance and activities. Explain how the radicalization concept plays in these cases.
Yeah, so first I think we just need to state the obvious, which is the term radical can in some circles, in some contexts, be treated as a badge of honor. And in other contexts, be treated as some kind of criminal characteristic. And it is not a coincidence that those who treat it as a badge of honor and who are not criminalized for doing so tend to be white people on the political right. And in fact, they are the base for people like Donald Trump and many other far right Republican elected officials. And they're often using that badge of honor to justify their own political dissent against wearing a mask during COVID or any kind or gun rights, defending their gun rights and so on and so forth. So they're hyper libertarian and they're quite anti-government and anti-government regulation, and proudly would say they were radical. That's a compliment to them. Yet you find that these same kind of elected officials anyway that represent these groups will then go and use radical as a criminal allegation, which being radical is not a crime in America, against those on the left, and especially against minorities that are on the left. So we saw after Black Lives Matter or during it that many of the Republicans accused this social movement, this anti-racist social movement, of being Black identity extremists. As again, trying to criminalize, first to delegitimize the social movement as if it was this extreme fringe threatening group, even though you had millions of people across the country who protested in favor of the movement as part of the movement, but also to try to criminalize it and setting them up to be treated similar to what we saw with Muslims post 9/11 and also with the COINTELPRO, which targeted many African-American civil rights leaders, anti-war advocates. And I would encourage people who are not familiar with the COINTELPRO era to read up on that in the 60s and early 70s, and also read up on the church, the Pikes Church Committee, the Church Committee hearings that essentially exposed this abuse of power. So all that is, I just wanted to kind of put that out there. But according to the government, you know, the radicalization theory, it's so laughable because it, at least for Muslims, right? They will argue that if some Muslim, especially it tends to be a young man, that's kind of the image of the radical Muslim, who becomes more religious, who starts to go prayer, the dawn prayer at the mosque, who may start engaging in more religiosity and also more political dissent, and may effectively adopt very critical and to some people offensive views or political views. And the government argues that this change in that person or this adoption of these religious and political views and practices is effectively a warning sign that they are about to commit a terrorist act. And so that's when the government justifies the sting operations to intervene, send the fake ISIS, Al-Qaeda person who is in fact an informant or an undercover agent, and lure them or ensnare them into a fake plot. And again, one, you know, there's multiple kind of counter arguments. The first is you could just leave them alone and all they will be is religious people with political viewpoints that you just might not disagree with and that might not be mainstream. And that's effectively how white people who have right-leaning, what we would consider kind of out of the mainstream views, are treated. And unless they take a specific act on their own, then they're just left alone and treated as fringe and effectively don't have really much impact. So the fact that so many government resources are going into this is part of that political economy of counterterrorism. But you need to be able to convince the public that there's an enemy, that there's an enemy within our borders. And once you convince them of that, then it's so much easier to take those billions of dollars to spend on the FBI and just create this surveillance machine and to broaden the authorities of the FBI. And this is one reason why libertarians have been an interesting and perhaps unexpected ally for the Muslim communities, is that although they tend to be more on the political right in the partisan political context, they are also very distrustful of government. And so while they may not care necessarily that it's Muslims that are being targeted by the expansive government surveillance, they certainly appreciate that once that expansive surveillance exists and those legal authorities exist, it's just a matter of time before it expands from Muslims to other groups, to everybody. So yes, radicalization, and the other thing is, I would my paper, State-Sponsored Radicalization, is effectively a very thorough literature review that examines what causes terrorism, right? There are all these theories of radicalization, that radicalization to become a terrorist. And the scholarship by academics, people who conducted empirical evidence, who have, you know, these are not just government bureaucrats who might have, again, political or economic interests in arguing radicalization theories, but these are academics. The literature is very clear that there is no cause, single cause of terrorism. There is no way to necessarily predict that a person will become a terrorist. It's very individually focused and case by case. And all of these theories are, they don't withstand any kind of empirical testing. And so what the government does is it just relies on stereotypes, racial stereotypes and profiling, which is lazy and a threat to the civil rights and liberties of the targeted community.
Yeah, exactly. And frustratingly, the indicators of radicalization that you mentioned are often very commonplace, are then also used as the justification, the predication, when you talked about how the entrapment defense works, where even if you're able to convince the judge that the government induced you to commit the crime, the government can rely on predisposition. And because they have this theory, they can say, well, this person was predisposed because he was more radical in his beliefs than somebody else. But as you say, this theory isn't applied equally, and particularly with the rising concern about anti-Semitism on college campuses. In 2017, we saw white supremacists with torches marching through the University of Virginia, chanting "Jews will not replace us." But we don't see the same kind of government response to that violence. Well, other than the obvious, or perhaps it is just the obvious, what do you think creates this dissonance in the way the government reacts to what it's calling terrorism, in depending on who is engaged or allegedly engaged in the activities?
Right. Well, I think this is an example of how racial privilege works. Is a couple of things are at play. The first is, when you have racial privilege, and it's a hierarchy, so I am a critical race theorist, and according to that kind of approach to race studies, the argument is that it's a hierarchy, and it changes, because race is a social construction. What is defined as white changes, what is defined as Black changes, etc. But thus far, since the beginning or founding of this country, and since the first settlers came from Europe, being socially constructed as white is the top of the hierarchy, and being socially constructed or raced as Black is the bottom. And then in between, you have multiple different identities that shift back and forth. So if you look at Asian Americans, there was a point in history in the late 1800s and early 1900s where there were laws that excluded Chinese and other East Asians from even setting foot into America, right? The Asian exclusion laws. Now, some Asians are perceived as a model minority, and so they may be treated better and be presumed with positive traits as compared to Blacks, right, or as compared to Arabs. It's complicated, but it's all comparative and it's relational. So when you are at the higher end of the hierarchy and at the top, if your race is white, you're presumed innocent individually. You're not presumed guilty based on the bad acts of somebody else who shares your identity. But that is not the privilege you have when you are a Muslim, for example, right? If there is a Muslim terrorist act, suddenly the racial profiling starts. The same thing with Blacks. If a Black person commits a high profile crime, suddenly the stereotypes that Black people are criminal or they're violent or that they deserve to be profiled to keep the rest of society, right? And the quote is, the rest is seen as a white society, safe. So when you see, so the Charlottesville white nationalist rally / riot, people are socialized to see those individual people as guilty of, or I should say as responsible for holding extremist beliefs, and some of them as guilty of committing a crime, right, if they actually violated the law. Having the protest itself and expressing those offensive views is not illegal, right? That's part of their First Amendment jurisprudence. But no one then takes that and assumes that every Republican and every Donald Trump supporter and every conservative who is white supports the Charlottesville rally slash riot. But that is not the case, for example, with Palestine. Hamas committed multiple war crimes on October 7th, 2023. And now Palestinians are held collectively responsible. And people who are criticizing the state of Israel for its disproportionately higher and more numerous and more frequent war crimes after October 7th, right, for the last 7 months, that has produced 40,000 killed 40,000 Palestinians, 14,000 of them are children in only 7 months. Another 75,000 have been severely injured. So that's over 100,000 Palestinians are dead or severely injured in less than 7 months. That's 5% of the population. 2.4 million are being starved to death. 1.7 million Palestinians have been permanently displaced and their homes have been permanently damaged. So you have people who are protesting that. And instead of being portrayed as anti-war activists, pro-human rights activists, no, they're being portrayed as Hamas supporters. Meanwhile, those who support Israel, no one is calling them genocide supporters. Nobody is alleging that they are all racists necessarily, right? And so that is one example of one point of data of how racism works and how privilege works. And so I think what's important to understand in the current context of Israel and Palestine and Gaza is that all of this, the last 22, 23 years has primed this country and all the generations who were alive and of age since 2001 to believe that Muslims, Arabs, Palestinians are sympathetic to terrorism. And that Jews, at least in this context, are given the privileges of whiteness vis-a-vis the Palestinians and the Muslims. That's not to say that anti-Semitism does not exist, but when we're talking about Palestine-Israel, the Jewish perspectives, and I say that it's diverse because it's plural, are given more weight, they are treated more seriously, and they are not used to defame and slander and marginalize all Jews in the same way that those who are defending the rights, the human rights of Palestinians are criticizing the Israeli military state practices.
Right. Mary, you had a question, or I saw your hand go up.
It was so long ago, Mike.
I'm sorry.
No, I'm just kidding. Thank you so much, Professor Aziz, for this very, very enlightening conversation. One of the reasons we started this is because we knew as academics we were analyzing stuff right and left, but to be able to hear what's going on the ground, to know that Muslim families and Muslim men, you know, there's still, I didn't know this, but there are over 400 men still in Guantanamo Bay, you know, in the prison in Guantanamo Bay. So this has been very enlightening, but I always like to end with something positive. And I know that's difficult, but are you winning any cases? Are any cases, do we have any hope that these cases can be won given the climate that we're experiencing now?
Yeah. So there is something very positive, and Mike and I think can relate to this because we are now old enough to be able to compare 2001, 2002 to 2005, to 2010, to 2024. And the most promising development has been the increase in cross-racial coalitions and the increase in intergroup collaboration against systems and structures and analytical frames that subordinate non-white communities in different ways, to different degrees, in different legal and practical contexts. But we are seeing a new generation of Americans that are also, well, white Americans as well, who are realizing that this isn't the type of country they want. And they're realizing that the history, to the extent they actually learn the history of the US through a more fact-based and evidence-based approach, that it's not a problem of the past, right? The society has become resegregated de facto instead of de jure. Mass incarceration of Black and brown communities is undeniable. Women are, you know, the reproductive rights are regressing back decades. So I think that the silver lining is that there these social movements that we've seen, Me Too, well, the LGBTQ movement, the Me Too movement, the Black Lives Matter movement, now I think the Palestine Human Rights Movement, and, you know, I think the reproductive rights movement is starting to gain some steam. These are interracial, cross-racial coalitions. And I'm optimistic that this new generation of college students and those who just graduated recently, I think that they're not, as they move into leadership, I'm optimistic that they're going to realize that the zero-sum game is not good for anybody, and that empowering minorities or stopping discrimination and stopping subordination of minority communities doesn't necessarily mean that you're now going to go and oppress white communities, is that we can have more equality and not necessarily hurt one group or the other. So that's my optimism. But I think that, you know, the challenge they're going to have is that they need to change systems, and systems are hard to change. I think their minds have been changed. I think they're reading more, you know, diverse things and realizing that not everybody has a lived experience, even though you live in the same country. But you can't change something unless you recognize first that it's broken. And that, I think, is a positive development, that our young people have realized that the systems and structures are not working. They're not sustainable. The country's diversifying at a very rapid rate, and that there's no reason why we can't figure out a way to create a more equitable society for everybody.
Well, if you're hopeful, we're hopeful too. So thank you. Thank you again on behalf of all of us, myself and Michael, do you want to take us out?
Professor Aziz, thank you so much for all the work you do. We'll keep the links to your website up, and thank you for putting all that data together, because of course that demonstrates that this isn't something that's a theory but actual fact. So thanks very much, and thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
And I'd also like to thank Thin Lee for helping us with all things IT in putting together the webinar. Thank you very much, Thin.
Thanks. Be well. Bye-bye.